Live. Hey, what's going on, fam? Welcome back. First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics. I am your host, the metaphysical Morpheus, aka Rev Shock, aka Shook Shock, Shook Shocker, Shockalicious, and Shocktimus Prime. With all of that being said, this is an amazing show today. As you know, it's Thursday. That means it's time to have some Black History Gems with Dr. Clyde Winters, our beautiful and beloved elder, and he is coming with some crazy ish today. He's getting ready to lay it out. He's getting ready to mess our minds up. I know that some of the stuff that you're going to see and hear, you cannot find anywhere else in the world. Dr. Winters, welcome back to the program. I understand you've been doing this kind of research for quite some time, because even Dr. David Imhotep was following your process in terms of research and uncovering a lot of things that people just absolutely have no idea about.
I've been looking at a lot of this, but you know, some people, I've even seen in some comments and people wanted me to talk about the Secret Space Command and all that type of stuff. But again, some things I stay in my lane, you know, and, you know, I just sometimes I like to just be Uncle Clyde, you know. that old plantation Negro just sitting around there drinking coffee. Got an interview. But again, this is very exciting. David, when we did our last meeting on your platform, he brought up the Mona Lisa on the moon. I really didn't want to talk about this, but I can tie it all together now. And I think it's going to be a show that many people are going to find interesting, you know, because whenever you look at ancient astronauts, they're always talking about how the aliens may have come here and gave the Egyptians knowledge and secret knowledge and stuff. But what we're going to talk about today is how the Egyptians were already had aeronautical technology. And this aeronautical technology allowed them to fly to the moon.
And my.
It'd be a very interesting thing.
Well, go ahead, Doc, because I know you got a special report associated with this that I'm going to put up in the chat. What's in the special, and it's pretty replete too. I think it's like 19, 20 pages. What's in this special report? Because this is one that I think we need to download for the books here. This is life-changing.
Well, it's the special report is, I'm going to tell you guys out there, you're not going to find any of this information anywhere that's pulled all together. It's a lot of different information about what some scholars have talked about the aeronautical technology of the Egyptians. But what I've done in this PDF is that I've really concentrated on all of the elements. I brought it all together. And you're going to be able to find, in a sense, that this PDF is going to blow your mind, because it has so much information in it, but it's all come together. You see, many people don't understand. I think I mentioned on the show before, a lot of the technology that the West has today, they get it from the Egyptians. Mm-hmm. They don't publish every text that they've translated. They go and they translate these Egyptian documents and they find out new stuff that they can do in the fields of science, medicine. Mm-hmm. And then they just, somebody at Harvard or somebody at University of London or somebody at Cambridge, they'll come out and say, hey, we made a new medical discovery. We made some new surgeries. And this stuff is not new. The Egyptians did it. But see, because of the fact they had a good Egyptology department, and when those people go over there and they find documents that tell them about these secret sciences, they use that knowledge to reproduce science over here. You don't know about it because of the fact that they want you to believe that the West is the master. But when you buy this PDF or my book on this topic, you're going to find, in a sense, that this PDF is going to give you the full information it doesn't really go into some of the prehistory of it, but what it does is that it'll give you, it's focused entirely on this subject. It's focused on Egyptian aeronautical technology, Egyptian aeronautical history, and how mm-hmm. the Egyptians went to the moon. You see, a few years ago, I saw this video on and it was about Apollo 20. And in this video, they showed the astronauts going throughout this this city they found on the dark side of the moon. They talked about the terminal. They talked about the spaceships. They talked about in a sense this pilot that they found that they call the Mona Lisa on the moon. And the thing is that many of those videos have been taken down. I'm sad to say, for some reason during the pandemic, they took down a lot of the videos that talked about 9/11 possibly being an being a process of the government. They took down all the videos on the Secret Space Command. You know, they're not gone. They're out there somewhere, but they've made it so hard that unless you know the exact address, you're not going to find that material. See, but the thing is that what I've been able to do in this up in my PDF and in this video, I brought all this information together, and it's information that is going to change your whole opinion. See, black people have always been going to the various planets. Usually we went into a cave or we went into a pyramid and we would astro travel. Travel to those planets and see what was going on. You see?
That's correct. But let's have a Dogon mapped out the stars. Absolutely.
That's right. But now I'm going to tell you that the Egyptians did it. And when you know that the Egyptians were able to go to the moon, you'll understand how those people came from Series B, and they came and they landed among the Dogon. You see, you are a brilliant people. You are a very inspiring people. You are a very, in a sense, scientifically oriented people. The only thing is that you've been conditioned. You've been conditioned to believe that you cannot do anything without the help of second frequency. You've been conditioned to believe that unless it comes from the European, it's not going to happen. But you don't understand. Anything that you think of in your mind that's creative, that's technological, that could really be helpful for mankind, you can make it. You can produce it. The only thing, in a sense, is that you've been conditioned to feel that you can't do it. But what you have to understand is that knowing is winning. Knowing is winning. When you know the information, when you know the facts, when you know who you are, when you know what you've done, then you know what you can do today. And that PDF is going to blow your mind.
Can't wait to take that deep dive in, fam.
That's right. And you know, you got to understand, in a sense, that at first I wasn't going to write this, but this PDF, but I want you to be able to have it in your hands. I want you to be able to feel it, to see it.
It's very important. Important piece of work.
But I did find some stuff that I put in the slides today that's not in the book, in the PDF, or in my book on this subject. So the slides are interesting. But again, like I said, I'll be interested to see what you guys think about it.
I cannot wait. Whenever you are ready, port that little puppy in there, and we're getting ready to go somewhere. Hey, the Sister Shanice Show. What's going on, beloved? I'm so honored to have, I was on your show. I forgot the date. I'm coming back. And then Dr. Winters, I think you're going on later this month. So, hey, sis, what's going on? Go travel abroad. What's up, my beloved?
I'm scared. I'm scared of Shanice. She's over there playing with those crocodiles. The crocodiles, baby. Over there in Gambia. And when the mother got us go over there dealing with the animal kingdom, you better watch out.
That's right. Greg West, what's going on, my beloved? I see you. Osa, I see you out there as well. Evolving Thoughts. Welcome, 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 all of you. Underdog Music, Cat, Wilkins, oh, that's Underdog, my boy Law with his music. Yes, that's the man. Go to firstfrequency.com and click on Music Ministry and download this, brother. Dad's Duchess, welcome back. Roy Wooter, see you back with us, brother. Pharaoh, see you with us all the way free. Oh, my gosh, all of y'all are just coming in. It's absolutely insane. Let's take this PowerPoint, put it in, and we're going full screen right now, Doc. Whenever you are ready, I'm going to mute my mic, and let's make it happen.
I'm taking you on a voyage. I'm taking on a voyage that our people have done. I'm going to talk about Egyptian aircraft and their voyage to the moon. Yes, I know many of you have heard about the helicopter glyph in the middle of this up at the top. That's called a helicopter glyph. They looked at this thing and they said that it's fake. No, this is what our ancestors did. You see, they found, look in the bottom left-hand corner, they found this sister on the moon. They call her the Mona Lisa because she was in a spaceship, baby. But a spaceship! They had taught you that you can't even make a damn cart. You can't even make a damn wheel cart. When I was a kid, we used to get these baskets, and they used to carry fruit in them. And we put wheels on them to make us a go-kart because we couldn't afford those other carts. But they tell you that we can't even make a go-kart. But today I'm going to tell you how the Egyptians made every technological aeronautical thing we see today. We made it first. Okay, again, you can go to my Patreon to see the slides. These slides are going to be very important because these slides, you're not going to find them up. You're not going to find a lot. Some of the information in the slides is not in the PDF or in my book. And the reason it's not a PDF or my book is that I added some stuff just today. My Twitter is at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. And again, as I told you before, my videos are on YouTube. And I'm going to make some other, I'm making new videos that I'm adding up at least maybe once or twice a week. Okay, what is FBA? FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, ancestry or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. You know, you hear some people talking about, you know, they couldn't have brought millions of Black people over to the United States. How could they put them on wooden ships? That's so silly. How do Europeans get over here in wooden ships? But when people in a sense don't think, you can tell them anything. You see? That's just like saying, oh, Europeans don't like to kill. During World War II, Europeans among themselves killed 50 million people. I'm not talking about 50 million Black people. I'm not talking about 50 million Aboriginal people. I'm talking about 50 million Europeans. They love to kill. And like most of us, they like money. But FBA is a lineage. We are, number one, these are things you need to know. We're Aboriginal Black Indigenous people native to the United States. Our FBA ancestry is African. Our FBA heritage depends on the tribal origins and presence in the varied states. Our Aboriginal FBA were the first slaves in the United States. Yes, yes. Europeans came over here and they captured Black Indians and they took a few back to London. Most of them died over there or died on the way there because you know, all those people so diseased and colds and stuff. But then many of them, they took to the Caribbean. You see, they took to the Caribbean. You know, some of my Aboriginal brothers, because they haven't really studied their history, and they're going to a powwow where they think some Mongoloid Indians are going to tell them about their history. They don't even know, man. They took these Black people, these Black Indians, took them over there to the Bahamas, to Bermuda, and they worked them to death. Yes, you know, identity matters. Terms used to make FBAs invisible was colored. minorities, African American. Today they want to say black and brown. No, FBA people are black. I know people hate to be called black, but there's nothing wrong with being black. A lot of great people call themselves black. 65,000 FBA fought in the Civil War to free themselves. 65,000! But in reality, it wasn't just 65,000. It was almost 200,000 FBA in the Civil War. This includes people in the Navy, the Army, and other auxiliary personnel. But 65,000 fought and they kicked butt because the fact is this is that we fought to free ourselves. Don't ever believe. Don't ever believe. Second frequency will give you your freedom without a fight. We had to fight to gain our freedom. You see? Yeah, they found other ways like Jim Crow, sharecropping, stuff like that to keep us in check. But no matter what they did, we're still here. We're still standing strong because we're a mighty, mighty people and a people that's not afraid to die and a people ready to fight for what they believe in. FBA culture is American culture, the food, the music, the language. Everything we did it, we made it. Every day you see them taking foundational Black American terms, you know, and then you see them in TV programs, even the British, even the around the world, they're always trying to copy off us because FBA is the standard, baby. American technological superiority was made by FBAs. We made the first digital phones. I mean, that's nothing new. That's nothing new. Remember, it was Granville T. Woods who made I think he made the first telephone. He made the telephones work. He worked with electricity and all that type of stuff. Louis E. Lattimore, he made the light. He made the light bulb. Electricity. These people, in a sense, were doing all type of technological things. We made the earth. We made, in a sense, the web. The web used to be a system that people, that the government was going to communicate with in the event of a nuclear war. It was a brother who made it come to life. Yeah, Gates made mucho dinero. You see, they made a lot of money off the internet and off Word and all that type of stuff. But it's all based upon we did. They can't do nothing without us. You see, FBA economic independence has always been obstructed by second frequency. Second frequency, when they see us making some money, when they see us try to get ahead, they always come on the scene and they try to destroy Black Wall Street, Rosewood, et cetera, et cetera. You know, after the World War I, when we came back, they wanted to kind of set us in our place. So they had those riots in Chicago, other places. In Chicago, on the Wabash Armory, they had guns in there back then. They don't have guns in the Black community anymore. I'll tell you why. Because during the riot of 1919, those soldiers who fought in World War I, they went down to the armory and got those guns, and they came out to defend themselves. That's why white people couldn't kill so many people on the South Side. You see, they couldn't burn down everything on the South Side because we had guns. But then later they called in the National Guard and the Army to kind of disarm us. But I tell you, we are fighting people. We don't like to fight. Nobody wants to die. Yeah, they talk about the gangbangers, but the gangbangers, who do they get guns from? They don't even have any damn money. Most of them couldn't even afford a damn gun, but they're giving guns. But my grandson, when he's going to the Finger High School, they're bringing guns, selling the kids for $50. You know, $50. Police officers had to pay more money than that for a gun, but they give you a gun to kill you. Self and each other. Finally, Aboriginal FBA, we adopted the Mongoloid Indians, and what did they do? Second frequency gave them our history.
All right, my good doctor, what and why should we call ourselves blacks?
We should call ourselves black because black people can be B1 based on culture, history, and land, yes. B1. The ancient Chinese, they call themselves Li Min, and Li Min means black people. They have a history. That's the dynastic history are the first rulers of China. They have a Chinese culture too. And that culture, you know, a lot of times the Mongoloids want to let our government go back many years. No! Your government go back to those Li Min, the black people who founded civilization in China. You know, in Assyria, yes, Assyria. If you turn on the TV right now and you go to YouTube, they're gonna show you some painted pictures of the Assyrians. They're so always bad. Painted because when you see the real pictures, when you see the pictures that they left, when you see their monuments in stone, they were black people because they called themselves Samekagadi. Samekagadi! Black people, baby. Yeah, they had wars with other black people. But I mean, hell, the Egyptians had wars with the Kushites. People have disagreements. You see? That doesn't mean that you hate each other. Then it says Sumer. Oh, Sumer. Sumer cat. The greatest civilization that white people are always trying to steal. I mean, talk about steal. The Sumerians, they call themselves black people. Sagiga! Sagiga! Because they were proud of their blackness. And especially the Egyptians. The Egyptians, they called themselves Kemetians or Kamiyu. And see, a lot of people say, oh, how can it be about, how can Kemet be about the Egyptians? Well, Kemet means the land, dummy. It all has a word, Kim in it. Kim means black. You add a T to it, it means black people, black land. You add in a sense, you add a U to it. You can say it can be humans or people. Get out of here, dummies. They were proud to be black people. The only people not proud to be black people today are these ignorant people over here in America. I'm a Moor. I'm a Christian.
Mm-hmm. Say it. Say it. Come on.
I'm not black. Yes, you are. I'll tell you what. Y'all just don't get in front of a mirror. Then you can tell yourself these lies. You can tell yourself these lies. Even in the Americas, the Aztecs, one of the greatest cultures in the history of Mexico. Yes. They lost that civilization because of the fact that when the Europeans came, second frequency came, they joined with those Mongoloid Indians and they tried to destroy the Aztec civilization. Because the Aztecs, they called themselves Mashika, Mashika, Ma, the great, she, black people, or black, Ka, the land. They called themselves the lords of the black land, baby, or the lords of the blacks. You dummies out there. Yes, you're dumb. You're dumb because you hate calling yourselves black. Well, all great people love being called black, baby. The Olmecs, the great Olmecs, those Olmec heads, baby. They called themselves in the self she because they were black. Don't you understand? Don't you understand who you are? You see, you know, even you so-called Christians and you so-called Muslims, if you read the Quran, if you read the Bible, they talk about Adam, Adamu. Adam was the first man. And they say he was what? Black or dark brown or red? Get the hell out of here. How can you call yourself a Christian, a Muslim, and then be ashamed to be called black when the first being that God created on this planet was Adamu, the black man? If I was in the street, I'd say nigga would, but I'm not in the street.
Are you from Chicago, Dr. Winters? That's a Chicago thing.
No,
that's what we say in the shot.
That's right. That's what those people in Chicago say. right now. Right now, Professor Winters.
I will not go down
to those depths of
That's right. That's exactly right, old boy. I do say. Now let me ask you a question, old chap. Is there any evidence of Egyptian aeronautical knowledge? I say.
Yes, sir. You're a chip off the old block. The following talk will discuss the archaeological, photographic, and textual evidence that indicate that the ancient Egyptians had an extensive aeronautical knowledge. A technology that allowed them to fly all the way to the moon. Yes, the moon, baby. This is a shocking idea for many people, because they assume that airplanes and rockets are modern technology associated with Europe. And past civilizations lack the technology to achieve the technological achievements of modern man. The idea that the ancient Egyptians may have visited the moon and had flying machines should not be discounted. Given the reality, we fail to be able to explain how ancient Egyptians built the pyramids. Yes, yes. These Europeans, they act like they know everything. They know when the world was created. They know when the dinosaurs did. Know when the dinosaurs died. They know when the meteor struck. But they can't even tell you how the Egyptians, our people, built the pyramid. Get out of here. But see, one of the things that allowed us in the early period to really understand that the Egyptians had this aeronautical knowledge was the Saqqara bird model. Here on the left, you see the Saqqara bird model. Some researchers believe that the ancient Egyptians may have known how to fly because of the wooden object found in room 22 of the Egyptian Museum in Cairo, Egypt. In room 22, we find a wooden object that appears to resemble a modern airplane or glider. Look at that. Look! It was excavated from a tomb near Saqqara in 1898. Archaeologists have dated the model to about 200 BC. Due to the model's similarity to a glider, some experts offer it as proof that the Egyptians possessed the technology of flight. Yes, this is a Saqqara bird model. There is writing on the model. The hieroglyphs on the model airplane say the gift of Amun or Amma. Amma was known in ancient Egypt to be the god of wind and air.
Think about that.
This model, by the simple fact it has on there, this inscription about Amun and the fact that Amun is the god of wind and air, it lets you know that black people bite was out there.
Look at this.
This is how this plane looks. This is how this model looks. This is what we're looking for. This is what we're talking about. The Egyptian artifact was first recognized as a possible aircraft by Professor Khalid Masjahiala, professor of anatomy for the artist at Helwan University, a member of the Royal Aeromodelers Club of Egypt and the Egyptian Aeronautical Club. This artifact special register number 6347, the number is 33109, is written on the bottom of the port plane. The model is made of sycamore wood. And do you know who first presented this? It wasn't Europeans who found this. Knowledge about this model was first published by Ivan Van Sertima in the African civilization, baby. It was black folks that brought to the attention of the world that the Egyptians had the aeronautical knowledge and the technology to fly.
Wow. So what does ancient Indian texts have to do with the Nile Valley, beloved?
Plenty. The Saqqara model is not only evidence of Egyptian flying craft. We also have the Ramayana. The Ramayana is about the Nile Valley. Oop, I'm going backwards.
No problem.
Okay. I know many of you guys have looked it up and saw the ordination ceremony, but the ordination ceremony was only one half of that particular tape. Because see, when you go to 119.33, you're going to find that we talked about the Nile Valley and the Rigveda. Yes, yes, yes. Egyptian ancient literature is not about India. It's about the Nile Valley. It's about the Egyptians.
Excellent.
All of you should go back and you should look at that ordination ceremony tape. Go to 119.33 after you see me and B-Man and my well, you can look at that too. But after you get to looking at that, don't get off the tape. Go to 119.33 and find out about how the Nile Valley is in the ancient Indian texts. Yes, yes. In my book, The Nile Valley History of the Rigveda, you can buy this book and I break down how the Indian texts are telling you about the Nile Valley. You can find out more information about the Nile Valley in my book, The World History of the Black Race, The Nile Valley History of the Rigveda. And I just published another book today. It's called The Egyptian Aeronautical Technology and the Egyptian Flight to the Moon. This book, it has more information in it. It has some information about the prehistory of the Kushites, how they developed came into this technology. But it'll give you the background, whereas my PDF focuses solely on Egyptian aeronautical history. These books are must. You need to buy them. You see, I don't write these books just for the hell of it. I write these books to let you know who you are, where you're going, where you came from. The only reason that America is so technological today, well, it used to be highly technological, is because FBA people are able to draw on those records. They're able to draw on those records because some of us accept the fact that we're black. And because we accept the fact that we're black, we can connect with those black people. Let me explain to you. I think it's the first law or second law of thermodynamics. Energy can neither be created nor destroyed. In other words, that dynamic technological events that black people made 1,000 years ago, 2,000, 3,000, 5,000, 100,000 years ago, it still exists. It's still out there. You can draw on that knowledge, but you have to know who you are. They tell you that you can't find no black nation. I showed you can't find black nations. They tell you that if you be black, you lost. That's a damn lie. If you say you're black, then you connect with the ancestors. The Assyrians, Sumerians, Egyptians, who said they were black like you. They don't know nothing about no Moors, no Christians, no Muslims, no Aboriginal tribes. They don't know about these African tribes. Hausa, Hausa, I don't know a damn thing about them. But when you say black, baby, when you say black, you're going to those records that our people left. It's in the sky. It's in the air. It's there. You just got to seek it and ye shall find it. Seek it and ye shall find it. The Vedas are religious texts composed in the Vedic Sanskrit, regarded as the oldest scriptures of Hinduism. The Puranas are a vast collection of Indian literature that cover Hindu legends and traditional folklore. This is what they teach you. But that's not the truth. The Rig Veda and other ancient Indian texts are about the Nile Valley, yes. The answer, according to Francis Wilford, William Jones, and Dr. Lini Srinivasan, is yes! Dr. Srinivasan has written several books and articles. She explains that the reason many locales mentioned in the Rigveda, Ramayana, and other texts are not found in India is because those toponyms, place names, come from the Nile Valley and the ancient Levant. Here's some of the books by Dr. Srinivasan. One of them is Desi, the other one was Kritij of Missing Links of the Rigveda. I'm telling you, these books are so thick. They got so much information in it, it'll make your head hurt. At least it made mine hurt. And it's not just that it made my head hurt. Dr. Srinivasan has studied this ancient literature and provides us keen insight into ancient Nile Valley and the Levant history. Many people would be surprised after reading her major books, Desi, Crete to Egypt, Missing Link of the Rigveda, and Near Eastern Deities in the Rigveda, to learn that the Rigveda, Ramayana, and other texts provide us information on ancient Nubia and the Dravidians in the Nile Valley. Those books aren't about no damn Hindus. Hindus think they white. They think they white. And they ain't talking about them. The ancient Indians recorded their history and elements of their civilization in texts called Puranas and Pali. Buddhists preserve their traditions in the Pali language. The Puranas are Hindu texts. The Puranas and Pali texts make it clear that the Shola were Kushites from Africa. Kushite, baby. The Dravidians lived in ancient Africa, even today. Yes. Even today, the Tamil language, which is a Dravidian language, is spoken in Cameroon. I bet you didn't know that, did you? They're not going to tell you the truth. Yes. Tamil is spoken in Cameroon. The Dravidians lived in ancient Africa. It appears that the Tamil belonged to the Nahisi tribes. And Telugu and Kannada belong to the Tehunu tribe. These people were called Hash or Kush, Hashkush by the ancient Egyptians. Cut you. I'm sorry.
Bless you.
Kashu was also referred to nations or countries and regions of India. Dr. Srinivasan noted that in ancient Indian texts, the Nile Valley was called Kusadivipa. Kushavipa, which means Kush land. The inhabitants of Kushavipa were named Kashi in the Indian literature. And the Puranas, Kusha was southern Nubia or upper Kush. In Purana, northern Nubia or lower Kush was called Kurunsha. Here's a map. Yes. Know who you are, where you came from. Dr. Srinivasan notes that the Nile Valley, Kush was called Kushadadipa. You see? In the Puranas, Kusha was southern Nubia or upper Kush. In the Purana, northern Nubia or lower Kush. Here's a map. A map. Yes. Know who you are, know where you came from, and you know where you're going or what you could do. In the Puranas and Pali texts, Nahisi corresponds to the Mindian Nahas, the name for the underworld abode of the serpent Ur, the metaphoric name for Nubia. If you notice, in a sense, as I told you, the Puranas and the Pali, they talk about the Nahisi, and the Nahisi represents the serpent. Have you ever noticed? Have you noticed that on many Egyptian monuments, you'll find that serpent on the pineal gland? Yes, the serpent on the pineal gland, because the serpent represented that hidden knowledge. Know who you are. Your history is right in front of your face. A major Kushite nation and tribe were the Wawat. The Egyptian semi-vowels changed into Sanskrit or Y or V. You know, in other words, those words that you find in Africa that begin with a W, often it becomes a Y or V. Srinivasan believes that Yad Yayadi. Yayadi was the name for Wawat. We also find in the Puranas a tribe named Vasha. Ovashishata. The Vasha tribe corresponds to the Wasi, Waset tribe. Shirinasan, according to Shirinasan, was the name for Thebes. It was also the name for the Nihisi or the Waset tribe. Here you can see in this map, you can see Wawat, the Magi, Temek, Yam, Pont. Yes, we had mighty nations. Stop letting these Europeans tell you that you had no history. Stop letting these Europeans tell you had no culture. Stop letting these Europeans tell you that you were just waiting in Africa, sitting in a hood, in a hut, chewing on some grass, waiting for them to come to bring you Jesus.
Come on.
You weren't. You already knew about Emma. God!
That's right.
During the old kingdom, the Kushites were also called Hekakashut. The term Hekakashut was used for the kings of the Nile Valley, Kushites and the Hyksos. The term Hekakashut appears in line 46 of the Winnie inscription. Hekakashut also appears in the epic Puranas as Ishibaku. Ishibaku, Hekakashut. See, you got to remember, the European has been teaching you for the past 100 years a lie. And that lie was that the Hyksos people were Hebrews, that the Hyksos people spoke Sumerian, not spoke Semitic languages. That was a lie. That was a lie because they didn't want you to know who your people were. That's what all the tribes that live in West Africa today originally lived around the Nile Valley. I will say it again. Mostly all the tribes that live in West Africa today mainly lived around the Nile River in the Nile Valley, because during the time of Egypt, much of West Africa was heavily forested. Because it was heavily forested, it was full of mosquitoes and flies that say fly. That meant it was a lot of disease there. But as the Green Sahara became a desert, places in West Africa opened up and people could move in there without fear of disease.
So what is the Ramayana?
What is the Ramayana? The Ramayana, what is it? That's a good question.
I don't know. That's what I'm asking.
One of the greatest texts in India is the Ramayana.
This yes. text
is important because it mentions Vimanas. Vimanas were flying vehicles. The Ramayana can be interpreted as the March of Rama. The March of Rama is the Ramayana.
Wow.
Much of the setting of the text is in Lower Egypt during the 19th dynasty of King Ramesses I. He was also called Paramesesu. Look! When you're reading the Ramayana, this is a nigga. I mean, this is a black. This is the gym they talk about.
Wow.
Look at that picture, baby.
Wow.
That is Rama of the Ramayana. You didn't know that, did you?
Nope.
They got these pictures. You go, you look over, you go to Hindi. India, and they got all these pictures of white people being in the Ramayana. They're not the ones. The Ramayana is about King Ramesses Paramesu.
Wow.
The rules of Voyage,
unbelievable.
Yes. The rules of
unbelievable.
Voyage identified themselves as Hyksos or Ishbashku kings. The Hyksos in Egyptian were called Hyksut. Tahiti, Bahasti, or Tahiti, Tasedi. See? Yes, the Hyksos weren't no foreigners. Second frequency tell you that so you will not know who you are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I want you to know they were black people. You see? The day is proven by the dream, haksut, kush, hashut. And you find these terms, haksut, hashut. You find these on Bula. And these Bulas come from ancient, from the Levant. And these Bulas go back to King Namar. Look over there, there's a picture of King Namar.
Mm-hmm.
That's King Namar. He's the one who unified Egypt. He's the one who took Egyptian civilization almost all the way around the world. And there's this Bula. And then this Bula, he talks about the Kashut, the Haksut, the Kush. See? Look at him with a kufi hat. You thought the kufi hat was just for the day. You see these brothers with a kufi hat. You say, oh, they must be Muslims. No, they just an African. African! Go back to Namar. He's one of the greatest Hyksos kings, King Apepi or Apophis. This was such a great king of Egypt because he kept all of the medical records. It was him. He kept the medical records. He kept the mathematical texts that we use today that the European uses to do surgery. That European do this because that matters. Apophis, baby. He was in Haksus. Do we look Hebrew to you? That's a Haksos right there, baby. Do we look Hebrew to you?
No, he does not.
The capital city of Lower Egypt was Avaris or Pyramisu. The house of the son of Ra, baby. We're going back to who? Ramesses I. I just showed you. The Ishkabaku recognized their line of solar kings, went back to King Mini Nama or Manu. Yes. When you see Manu in the Indian text, they're talking about Minis or Namar. Rama had two sons, Lava, which was Libya, and Kush, which was Nubia. Stop it, baby. Stop it. Do you know who you are? Stop it. Do your own research.
Mm-hmm. Incredible.
There's been an aircraft in the Ramayana. The manuscripts did not definitely say that interplanetary travel was ever accomplished, but did mention of all things a planned trip to the moon. However, in one Indian epic, the Ramayana does contain a highly detailed story of a trip to the moon in a Vimana or Astra. And in fact, it tells a battle on the moon with an Asden or Atlantean airship. Yes. If the Ramayana is about Ramesses I, then that means that those Egyptians was flying them ships, baby. Hanuman, upon entering Ravana's palace in Lanka for the first time, sees Pushyapakvimana and also feels Ravana's palace is as big as a flying plane. Translation, being shown by the best among women like a cloud, by lightning being worshipped, like being carried by the best ones, like an aerial car full of splendor of good people in the sky. Yes! Ramesses! One! Was riding in the sky, baby. Here's another phrase. There the great Hanuman saw a great aerial car, the best among best of aerial cars, shining with the name of Pushpaka, with the rays of precious stones and capable of traveling long distances. The name of Ramesses I, we don't know too much, but the name of his mother in the Ramayana was Kaikai. See, and in the Ramayana, we find in a sense that Rama, Ramesses I, was an Ikshavahu. Let me read what it says in the Ramayana. And this is what Kekai was saying to her Lord. You have promised me the granting of two boons, and you have sworn to it in the name of Rama, your darling son, Rama, and now I'll speak out my mind. If you reject my demand, you will be the first of the Ishvaku race, proud descendants of the sun god, Vaiva, to go back on a promise for the sake of convenience. She took breath and demanded, banish Rama to the forest for 14 years and come out Wadarada and celebrate his enthronement with the arrangements we have already made. Yes! Rama, Ramesses, when he came to the throne, when Horeb made him his son, he was old already, but he had two children! Said he was a great and mighty ruler, but listen, listen, listen! When you know that the Ramayana is talking about Ramesses, what? Look, look, look! That's you.
You're passionate, my brother. I love it. Keep it coming.
Let me quote the Ramayana. At one stage of the battle, Rama and Lakshmana, that's his brother, were attacked by Indrajit, and the serpent darts employed by him made him swoon on the battlefield. Indrajit went back to his father to proclaim that it was all over with Rama and Lakshmani, and soon, without a leader, the monkeys would be annihilated. Ravana rejoiced to hear it and cried, did not I say so? All you fools believe that I should surrender. He added, go and tell Sita that Rama and his brother are no more. Take her high up in Pushvak, Vimana, my chariot, and show her their bodies on the battlefield. His words were obeyed instantly. Sita, happy to have a chance to glimpse a long-lost face, accepted the chance, went high up, and saw her husband lying dead in the field below. Sita was the wife of Rama! Stop, 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 stop. He broke down. How I wish I had been left alone and not brought up to see this spectacle. Ah, me, help me to put an end to my life. Trijata, one of Ravana's women, whispered to her, don't lose heart, they are not dead. And she explained why they were in faint. In due course, the effect of the serpent darts was neutralized when Garuda, the mighty eagle, the born enemy of all serpents, appeared on the scene. The venomous darts enveloping Rama and Lakshmana scattered as they approached him. Garuda! Yes, sir! He was the leader of the monkey troops. They weren't monkeys, baby. They weren't monkeys. The entire description of the Pushpavimana was given to Amana and the Sandrakanda Etanga. The translation, Hamuna saw that aerial plane, which Rakshas, who were great eaters, with a face beautified by earrings to roam around the sky, space, and thousands of genii, and round eyes, crooked eyes, and wide eyes, capable of great speed, carrying it. Yes! Flying, baby! Brahman, the chariot of the gods. This comes from, in a sense, the Ramayana, page 244. The gods in heaven noticed Ravana's determined move and felt that Rama would need all the support they could muster. They requested Indra to send down a special chariot for Rama's use. When the chariot appeared at his camp, Rama was deeply impressed with the magnitude and brilliance of the vehicle. How has this come to be? He said. Sir, the charioteer answered, my name is Matali. I have the honor of being the charioteer of Indra, Brahma, the four-faced god and the creator of the universe, and Shiva, whose power has emboldened Ravana now to challenge you, have commanded me to bring it here for your use. It can fly swifter than air over all obstacles, over any mountains, sea, or sky, and will help you emerge victorious in this battle. Rama reflected aloud. It may be that the Rakshasa have created this illusion for me. It may be a trap. I don't know how to view it. Whereupon Matali spoke convincingly to dispel the doubt in Rama's mind. Rama, still hesitant though, partially convinced, looked at Hanuman and Lakshmana and asked, what do you think of it? Both answered, we feel no doubt that the chariot of Indra is not an illusionary creation. Yes, Yes, this was a flying machine.
My, my, my.
If Rama, Ramesses one lived, and we know Ramesses one lived, if Ramesses one lived, and it said they had flying machines, mm-hmm. it must be proof. Again, Ravana suddenly realized that he should charge his tactics in order his charioteer to fly the chariot up in the skies. From there, he attacked and destroyed a great many of the monkey army supporting Rama. Rama ordered Matali, go up in the air. Our young soldiers are being attacked from the sky. Follow Ravana and don't slacken. There followed an aerial pursuit of dizzying speed across the dome of the sky and the rim of the earth. Yes, this is Ramesses one, baby. Ravana's arrows came down like rain. He was bent upon destroying everything in the world, but Rama's arrows diverted, broke, or neutralized Ravana's terror-stricken. The gods watched the pursuit. Presently, Ravana's arrows struck Rama's horses and pierced the heart of Matali himself. The charioteer failed. Rama paused for a while in grief, undecided as to his next step. Then he recovered and resumed his offensive. At the moment, the divine eagle Garuda was seen perched on Rama's flagpole, and the gods who were watching felt like this could be an auspicious sign. After circling the globe, baby, the dueling chariots returned, and the fight continued over Lanka. It was impossible to be very clear about the location of the battleground, as the flight occurred here, there, and everywhere. Rama's arrows pierced Ravana's armor and made him wince. Ravana was so insensible to pain and impervious to attack that for him to wince was a good sign. And the gods hoped that this was to turn for the better. But at this moment, Ravana suddenly changed his tactics. Instead of merely shooting his arrows, which were powerful in themselves, he also invoked several supernatural forces to create strange effects. He was adept at the use of various thoughts that he could be a dynamic attacking. Yes. Yes. Yes! They're talking about Ramesses one. This is not just a made-up character. Ramesses one. The Pushkar-Vimana is described similar to a huge jumbo jet in the Sudara Kanda and the Yudha Kanda. The Vishnahina says that after lunch, Rama can reach Ayodhya before sunset if he travels in the Pushpakavimana. He says with the Pushpakavimana, about 2,200 kilometers can be traveled in less than 5 hours. Baby, these people had ships that could fly, almost like jets, which means they can travel at 440 kilometers per hour. It carried Rama, Sita, Lakshman, along with the entire Vamana army. So it must be of great dimension. Yes, look at that. Look at that brother. Look at that brother on the right. That's Ramesses one. They're talking about a ship that could tires and giant that could hold this entire army. You can't imagine that. You can't imagine that. Because second frequency and told you only they can do stuff like that. Only they can make a jumbo jet. Only they can make cargo ships. Dummy, we did it too.
That's right. Bring it on. Bring it on.
There are other
Bring it on.
There are other varieties like fighter jets used by Indrajit in the war to travel at supersonic speeds and emit smoke. Helicopters used by Ravana to abduct Sita. Sita was Rama's wife from middle of the forest, which landed and took off without any landing strip. While Ravana's army flew in bunches on Vimanas, Banaras flew individually in their flying machines. This description of Banaras flying suggests that they might have gliders floating on the air currents, which was noiseless. All the Banaras were not able to fly. Only a few could fly, and they formed a platoon or a flying squad. Rama ordered his flying squad to fly forward and search the Datiyas, Ravana's men hidden in pits of forest castles. This arrangement is just like the modern war tactics. The capacity of their flights was measured in Yovianas. Jambavana says he can fly 80 Yovianas as he became old. Angada says he can fly 100 Yovianas. I am minimum 400 miles at a stretch. Yes. Yes! You mighty, mighty black people.
Come on, Doc.
Be one! Yes, sir. Okay, this is what
love it.
But Rama said after he freed his wife, Sita. Rama remained brooding for a while and suddenly said, my task is done. I have now freed you. I fulfilled my mission. All this effort has been not to attain personal satisfaction for you or me. It was to vindicate the honor of the Ishvahu race as to honor our ancestors, codes, and values. After all this, I must tell you, there's not customary to admit back to the normal married fold a woman who has resided all alone in a stranger's house. There could be no question about living together again. I leave you free to go where you please and to choose any place to live in. I do not restrict you in my manner. On hearing this, Sita broke down. My trials are not ended yet, she cried. I thought with your victory, all our troubles were at an end. So be it. She beckoned to Lakshmana and ordered Knight of Fire at once on this very spot. Yes! Sisters! Look at what you do to a black man! You make a black man want to just fly and fight anywhere!
That's right. That's right. We do it for you, baby.
Baby! Ain't nothing like a black woman. I should know. I was with my wonderful for 50 years. Ain't nothing like a black woman. Nothing like a queen. Be one.
Absolutely. All right. Here's the next question. What is the helicopter glyph? A lot of people say that was a lot of people try to argue, say, oh, that was just accidentally was a part of another glyph and it just looks like a helicopter. It's not couldn't be a helicopter.
No, it couldn't be a helicopter, could it?
No, boy, that's impossible. We know those Negroes can't fly like that. We know that. Right. Yes.
But at the Temple of Ramesses I at Abydos, also known as the Temple of Osiris at Abydos, the Temple of Ramesses I at Abydos, you see, this is where, in a sense, they found the helicopter glyph. You know, Ramesses I, he made the he the one who established the building of it. He set the he gave the money for it. It was completed by his son Seti I. You know, it was dedicated to the cult of Osiris, the god of the dead, the lord of Abidjan or Abydos. This is the helicopter glyph. Wait a minute. What? This is real? Yes, it's real.
Yep.
They found this in Abydos. Look at this. Look at this. Already told you.
Yeah, you can't make that accidental because there's too many of the glyphs and they're in a certain order, and that is just who we are. So it's blatant, and so we just have to be able to accept this. You know, it's like, okay, wait a minute now. When we look at the Dogon, how was the Dogon able to map out stars that they couldn't see with without a telescope? You have to understand why would Amma put us here first? There's a reason, fam. I keep telling y'all this, that we're the best of the best because we're the first. What we are going and growing through right now with Amu is a temporary thing. It was to happen so that we could understand that you, me, Dr. Winters, all of you are the living, walking Christ. We are the Christ consciousness made manifest in physical form. We've gone through the crucifixion. It is now time for our resurrection. Our resurrection is this information that is going to turn into transformation. This is what we're doing here, fam. This is not a joke. This ain't no damn hobby. This is real life. Keep it coming, Doc.
This is the panel. Look, this is the panel. You can see it's part of is part of even more glyphs. Stuff. This is an actual panel. You see? From the Temple of Abydos. I'm from EC1. Yes. Yes. You see? Second frequency.
Wow.
But he tell you it's all made up. Why is it, if it's made up, why do we still see it? Why do they have it there in the temple, baby? You see?
Love it, love it, love it.
What do we see on this glyph? We see helicopters. We see planes. We see a spaceship. There's something else. I don't know what that is. Maybe that was a submarine. I don't know. You did this. Our ancestors did this. Mm-hmm. They made helicopters, planes, spaceships. And how do we know that? We go back to the pushpuck of a minor. What does it say? There were other varieties like fighter jets used by Indrajit in the war to travel at supersonic speeds. Helicopters used by Ravana to abduct Sita from the middle of the forest, which landed and took off without any landing strip. You see it in the helicopter glyph. This is what Ramesses I had at his disposal. Just because you see some brothers running around with spears, that don't mean they wanted to make projectile weapons. Why do they need projectile weapons? Man to man, bone to bone.
Absolutely.
Whoa. The Ramayana talking about Ramesses I, and look what we find in this temple. We find in the temple that was built for Ramesses I. We see these flying vehicles, and they told you you can't do nothing, but can't even make a damn car. You cause you're a Negro. Cause you come from Africa. The Egyptians came from Africa too, baby.
And we were first to do it. Now, Melvin Reed, I love you much, but I'm going to correct you just a little bit with some loving you back. You say, I'm going to put this up on the screen, my beloved. You say, when the Europeans get out of our way, we'll be great again. My beloved, we've always been great. We always will be great. And there was never a time when we were not great. And we don't need the European or anybody to be here or not be here for us to know that we are the best of the best, the first of the first. And the reason that we have a Dr. Clyde Winters is demonstrative of the power of Amma. You can't free yourself. You can't win until you know who you are. You can't take back your land, your country, or whatever until you know who you are, until all of this bickering going back and forth. We're trying to establish you, us, all of us, as first frequency, be one. Whatever that country is, whatever your nation is, whatever your geographical location is, you are foundational there. You are foundational. But you don't know, if you don't know who you are, how do you fight? You can't fight for something that you, if you don't know what you are. This is the restoration of the resurrection. Go ahead, Doc, please.
Okay, and so here we see that airplane from the helicopter glyph. And then we compare it to the Saqqara Egyptian bird model. Look at that. Look how close they are in dimensions. Look how close they are in design. The hieroglyph on the bottom of the airplane of the model says gift of Amun. Amun in ancient Egypt was known to be the god of the wind and the air, and that's what these brothers was doing. And it's true. They was in the air. They didn't, you know, people say, well, why didn't they continue to use it? Why should they continue to use it? We're not a lazy people. Why'd they have to keep fighting in airplanes and all that? They only did that because they had to use them at that time. Let me ask you a question. How did they build a pyramid? How did they move those gigantic stones? How did they put those gigantic stones in place? Now you see, it wasn't because they got some information from out of place. They already had the knowledge, but. Some researchers believe that the glyphs are not representative of modern Mecca. You know, they believe in a sense that this is the up panel, and they believe what the panel really says is it has nothing to do with flying ships has nothing to do with Mecca. Catherine Griffin Greenberg, Griffin Greenberg, if you know her, she was a very kind of an she used to ride the fence, but she was kind of against Afrocentrism. You know, she says that we clearly see what this she said, we clearly see who repulses the nine bows, which figures in some of the two ladies' names of Seti I, replaced by who protects Egypt and overthrows the foreign countries. Two ladies' names of Ramesses II, with some of the plaster that once covered Seti I tituary. Now look at this. See, the knowledge is hidden right there, says what? Who protects Egypt and overthrows the foreign countries. Wasn't Ramesses I protecting Egypt? Wasn't Ramesses I fighting Rabada? But he had to use what? He had to use flying ships. There's the knowledge right there in front of your face. They put the figures there, but they also let you know what they were there for. Ramesses I had to use those flying vehicles to do what? To protect Egypt and overthrow the foreign country.
Oh, here we go now. You get ready to start some ish. What was Apollo 20?
In 2007, a man identified with the username Retired Dab posted on YouTube videos about an alleged joint American-Russian secret mission to the moon in 1976. This was a shocking video because NASA claimed that the Apollo 20 mission was canceled. Yes. NASA said that the Apollo 20 never took off. But this man said it did. He said that Apollo 20 did go to the moon. The person who possessed the video was later identified as William Rutledge. He claimed he was a former astronaut living in Rwanda. According to Rutledge, Apollo 20 landed near the Delport crater. His mission was to explore a large cigar-shaped craft inside the spaceship. There were two astronauts found, two corpses. Think about that.
My.
They were there to explore a cigar-shaped craft. Did anybody see a cigar-shaped craft anywhere? Yeah.
Yep, we just saw it.
It's on the helicopter glyph. The video footage showed the cabin of Apollo 20 on the moon. It also showed a lunar city, spacecraft, and a female corpse who was the pilot of the spaceship. Yeah, and you know, I really wish I could see that whole video again, because it showed them going around the spaceport. It was a spaceport. They're all type of good stuff. Interesting. Apollo 20 allegedly landed on the moon in 1976 and found a spacecraft and pilot. This is a picture of the pilot, and on the right hand side, you can see a picture of the craft that they were there to investigate. These pictures are all associated, they claim, with the Apollo 20 flight that NASA said never took place. Not liars. But look at this. Look at this. What? This is an official photograph of NASA. And this photograph was taken by Apollo 15. This shows the same ship. Look. Here's the ship that they photographed in 1976 by Apollo 20. And look, this was photographed by Apollo 15. NASA got them on their site, baby.
Wow.
They no made up ish. Moonship and the Egyptian. Look at that moonship. Look at the moonship. And then compare it to the ship on the glyph. Look at that. Look at that area. And then down here is the ship. Look there. See that? Is that a coincidence? Hell no.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I know y'all out there saying, don't curse Dr. Winters. But I can't help myself. I'm from Chicago.
Aren't we both? Oh, our bad mouths.
Look at those ships. Look at the ships.
Great work, Doc. Great work. My gosh. Incredible. Incredible discourse.
An Egyptian ship. There's clear evidence that the Ramayana and other ancient Indian texts are about the Nile Valley. These texts make it obvious that the people living in this area had aircraft called Vimanas. The helicopter clip from Abydos and bird model makes it clear that the Egyptians knew about aircraft. As reported in the Ramayana, the alleged spaceship found by the crew of the Apollo 20 resembles the craft on the Abydos helicopter glyph and indicates that the Egyptians had traveled to the moon. Look, baby, look. I want you to just look at this for a while. I don't have to make up nothing about our great history.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They put your great history out there, but you got to do the research to find it.
Mm-hmm.
Look! Look! This is a ship. The push back of Vimana is described as similar to a huge jumbo jet in the Sundara Kanda and the Yudha Kanda. The Vibhishana says that after lunch, Rama can reach Ayodhya before sunset if he travels in the Pushpaka Vimana, which means it can travel at 440 kilometers per hour. Look at this ship. They estimate that the ship was, look at it, was taller than the damn Eiffel Tower. It was longer than the damn modern ocean liner. Look! Don't you see that this ship could have carried an entire army, right? Look how big it is. And the Ramayana made clear that aircraft in the Nile Valley was gigantic since they could carry an entire army. The size of the ship could carry such a force. Is it any wonder that if the Egyptians could make spacecraft like this, building a damn pyramid was simple.
Well said, well done. Hey, yes.
Look at that ship. Look at that comparison. The ship on the helicopter glyph and the ship they found on the moon.
All right, now talk about the Mona Lisa on the moon.
The pilot of the ship found on the moon is called the Mona Lisa. This is how she looked after they took off the various apertures. I don't know why as a pilot she had to have things connected to her eyes and her nose. But look, the main spot was that circle in the middle. That's where the ancient Indians always put a dot, right? Right where the pineal gland is, that's where they also put the snake or the serpent. Baby, what does that tell you? Know who you are. Here she is. That's how she is with all those fixtures on the eyes, her mouth, all that type of stuff. Some type of communication, I guess. I don't know. But I bet you, if we could get into all those monuments, and I bet you, if you could go and translate that material yourself, if you knew metanetter, you might find out more about this. Mm-hmm. But don't you keep holding your breath until the second frequency tell you. Keep holding your breath. That's gonna be you. Because you're gonna stop breathing, baby, before they tell you. That's a pilot.
No doubt.
And she was one of the pilots of that ship.
Wow.
I tell you, you know, over here, the European, he always feels he got to keep his woman and keep her private. And really, he see a woman like a damn cow or a horse. You know, there's mm-hmm. school, horse, cow, whatever, anyway, sheep, see?
Mm-hmm.
But in our society,
all kind of farm animals.
That's right. In our society, in Black society, our women are precious to us. And they're not only precious,
yes, sir.
But they can do whatever we can do.
That's except right.
make babies, baby.
Yep, we can't do that.
They can't do that. I do that. Look at her. A beautiful sister. But again, look at that. Look at what that. Look at what that circle is in on her forehead. It's telling you something. How do you see, but you don't see? That penal gland. I mean, a lot of brothers back in the 80s and 90s, they used to write about the penal gland. That penal gland is a mother.
So, Dr. Winters, is there writing on the spaceship found on the moon?
Damn straight.
Oh, stop it now. You just showing out. You're showing out on national national YouTube. International this YouTube.
Man, this is
the
hull of the ship.
Come on now.
Look at there. Look at those characters. This is thin eye writing on the ship.
May I say something, Doc, may I say something to the family for a second?
Go ahead.
And to you as well. This is what I'm talking about. If you look at this, if you look at what Doc has just shown us, look at all the movies that they've made, like Ridley Scott's Alien, and look at the ships and how the ships are designed. And you remember how there was a point that science fiction movies, it was something that happened where it went from Star Trek to, it was like all of a sudden there was these spaceships that they were building and they look so real and they were so detailed. Guess where they got all of this stuff from? They're not that creative. They got this from us. It's already been established and they've already found it. Go ahead, Doc.
And the thing is that I don't know how many of you remember Stargate. Stargate.
Yes, yes.
You know, had these Egyptians going around the universe. You thought yes. they made that up, didn't you? I can't prove it.
No, nope, but that was real.
A lot of movies they make be telling you about things that actually exist.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They make it like a movie because they can't tell the truth. But this is writing on it. You see, listen, this is thin eye writing. I discussed the thin eye writing in my books, The Dawn of Writing, Decipherment of the Thin Eye Dysphilio Tablet, and the Göbekli Tepe Pillars. In this book, I show that the thin eye writing has been in use for the past 10,000 years.
And this was the writing that was on the ship.
On the ship.
And my goodness.
African origin world writing systems. I also talk about tonight. We are mighty people. I've been trying to tell you. Just because that European
first frequency.
Just because second frequency always tell you that you don't know how to write, that you're illiterate. We're just an oral culture. No. We've always been a literary culture. We've always been writing. See? They can't tell you this because they don't want to believe it. The ship was named Tekako. See, here's the writing on the ship. There are five thin-eyed characters on the nose. Thin-eyed is red from right to left. The triangle sign is pa. The pas sign means mark of aberration or the seal of approval. So that triangle sign means the mark of approval or seal of approval. The other four signs read Tekako. What does Tekako mean when you translate it? That was the name of the ship, but what does it mean? It means propriety in the company of this sacred object of respect. Your history is in front of you.
Right in front of us. It's right in front of us. I just took the words out of my mouth. Right in front of us.
If this was made up stuff, How can the words have meaning? That's because a sister flew that rocket to the moon, to a base they had on the moon.
Absolutely incredible.
Be one.
See, this is the fight. You can't fight for reparations if you don't have the information of transformation. You got to have proof with these folks. You got to have proof and knowledge to know. So there's something happens when you know unequivocally it's your land. It's something that happens to you when you unequivocally find out that it was stolen from you. That this is your history today, just as much as it was our history of our ancestors when we were battling them. That's why Doc is doing what he's doing. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing, proving first frequency consciousness all day, every day. But we have to get the consciousness back. How do you get the consciousness back? You got to know who you are. You've got to know all the details and all of these various different aspects and disciplines to know who you are. We've got Dr. Marie Charles coming back this month to talk about first sight consciousness. So we can start moving into that phase where we begin to not only know who we are, but then we start moving like a god. We start moving like a goddess or an ama in expression. Our esteem raises, our character raises, our shoulders go back, our chest comes out. We are proud people because we are the first people. Don't get it twisted. What we're going through right now, this species, this subspecies that's on the planet with us, is an accident, and it's a blip in the matrix in terms of time. It's a blip in 500 years, nothing, just or however many years, 3,000 or whatever years total. But what, 500 years we've been going through this here, Doc? That's nothing.
That's nothing.
But we got to know how to extend. Our ancestors left us the blueprint so we can restore ourselves.
That's right. And
see, this is a SAR. We're putting ourselves back together again. They left all of the body parts, all the clues, all the information, but we have to go and get it. This is why I'm also excited about being in your research class, because you're teaching us how to do the level of research that you do, that Dr. David Imhotep does. I want to know how to do, and we want to know how to do, so we can bring that to the community in the way needed and necessary. Go ahead, Doc.
And see, that's why it's important. That's why I didn't write my books just for the hell of it. I wrote my books because each one of my books, all 38, 39, whatever the hell they are, each one of those books are telling you the secrets of our history.
Mm-hmm.
If you study my books, you see, if you had my book, The Dawn of Writing, or you had my book, The African Origin of Writing Systems, see, you would have looked at this and you would automatically said, damn, that ship got words on it. But when you don't know our writing, then you'll be like the European. What's up, Doc?
Right, exactly. Well, exactly. Whoops. Yep, absolutely.
It was called a Tekako. Here's some more writing that they found on the ship. There's some more information that they found. See, and then, as I said before, it appears that the Luca Scantambulo, he was an Italian ufologist. He found the NASA archive photos of Apollo 15. And these photos from Apollo 15, they support the presence of a large cigar-shaped craft on the moon. I'm not making this up.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You thought Dr. Witness was just going to talk some ish.
We know better than that now.
You thought Dr. Witness wasn't going to bring no receipts.
Come on now.
I don't play, baby.
No, you do not. No, you do not. No, you do not.
This is what you're going to find when you get our PDFs. Those PDFs, I meant to set the world on fire. You're getting knowledge that they don't even teach you in the schools. They don't teach you in the universities because they don't believe you can do it.
Facts. Facts. Phenomenal work.
You can't make this stuff up. But Apollo 20, that never existed. They show the same damn pictures, only close up. They show the pilot. In summary, the Apollo 15 photos resemble the pictures of a cigar-shaped spaceship allegedly taken by the Apollo 20 crew. The discovery of the Apollo 15 photos by Scantamburlo support the authenticity of Rutledge's Apollo 20 photos of the spaceship. The discovery of the alleged spaceship on the moon is very interesting. It's interesting because the helicopter glyph and the Ramayana make it clear the Egyptians had flying vehicles and that this ship had been manned by Egyptian pilots. The Ramayana acknowledged that during the battle between Ravana and Rama, the conflict may have spread to the moon. This makes it obvious that the Egyptians had experience traveling to the moon. The Egyptians may have been the builders of the city on the moon, found by the here's some of the references. It's references in the PDF, but it's also references here in the on the slide. I'm not playing, baby.
No, you're not, baby. No, you're not. No, you're not.
Understand who we are, what we are, where we came from. We're flying in space. Yes. We're flying in space. Yeah. Help! 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 Rabbit is on your phone. Help!
I unleashed the Kraken. I unleashed the Kraken out here on the family. I am so honored that I did such a thing. I am. I'm loving this.
It's all your fault.
Okay. I'll take it. But I tell you what, the folks that are watching this live right now, over 200 people, and the people who will be watching it, your life ain't going to be the same after this. See, it's a layering effect. I know, fam, because it happened to me and it happens to all of us as we move through this consciousness of, and going back to Dr. Obadashaka's framework of the sixfold stages to mental freedom, when we reach that fifth level of African consciousness, there's layers and levels to African consciousness. Like when you first, quote unquote, become awakened or woke, you come into this knowledge and information. As you know, as I know, there's a lot of misinformation, even from our own group of scholars and tribes. And so we're trying to figure this thing out as we become more mature and more adept. We begin to make sense of what has happened to us, knowing nothing is wrong with us. We start to see exactly how they have taken everything, appropriated everything. And then you get a Dr. Winters. Now, when a Dr. Winters come into your experience, I saw this in the chat, somebody said, hey, this dude has put all of the other things together in such a great way that now all of the stuff that I've learned, now it makes sense, right? So there's a layering effect. We're baking this transformational cake so that we can feast on it. We can restore ourselves. We must repair ourselves before we ask or receive, I should say, any reparations from any place else. We must do this ourselves. And it's starting with first frequency of oneness and what Dr. Winters is doing. Love you, sir. Love it. Love this information.
And the thing is, this is that, like I told you guys, the history is right in front of your face. But if you don't know how to look, that's why I wrote all those books. I don't write the PDFs. I don't write that for nothing. I write those things so that those people who are wise, they will have the knowledge that they can see through the mist. They can see through the visible. They can see through the visible. Your history
That's correct.
Is in front of your face.
It's right there. It's right there.
But if you don't know your history, you won't even see yourself in that in that play.
And this is the thing. We should actively do what makes Amu afraid. Amu is afraid of us getting knowledge. So that should be our number one journey. That should be our number one goal, is to get the knowledge, because they already know what happens when we get the knowledge. It will shift the entire world. And then we get to help Amu help them go through this birth dearth and this reduction until they're no longer a species that we have to deal with and tolerate.
And see, and what you have to understand is that the European, he operates off steam. You see, he operates, look at how the Egyptians, they had flying vehicles. They flew to the moon. Mm-hmm. They weren't talking about the earth was heating up. They weren't talking about the climate was changing, all that type of stuff. Because he's a European, he deals with a synthetic science.
Mm-hmm. And all that ancient alien crap that they do on History Channel, you know, it's like you got to decipher that crap. It's like we're not ancient. We're not aliens. We're not ancient either. We are the all. We are it. So when Amma makes something, it's the all. Amma is the all. And so therefore, we are the all. I used to in my second book, there's a principle I use that said, God is, I am. So whatever God is, you are, right? So whatever God is, I am. And so Amma is, therefore, you are. You must be Amma in expression. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't have been chosen first to be here. You would not have been African if you were not made in the image and likeness of Amma. And when we talk about this concept of melanin, and we talk about this understanding of the equator, the northern, southern crater, and all of that stuff, look at the world, look at the cosmos. Everything is black. In order to see light, it must be black. There's darkness, dark matter, dark energy, gravity. So that's carbon. And we are carbon-based people, and that is why we are the best of the best and the first of the first. Anything that comes after us is working itself off the planet, is recessively genetic. Something that's recessively genetic is dead or dying, right? So death and dying is what the Amu we have experienced brings to not only our lives, but their own lives. They kill each other. They kill everything. That's what they do. Because they're an accident of nature, and they devolved as a result of that devolving. We've seen a species that we've never seen before. So here we are.
You know, but the most important thing is to remember is that, as I told you before, is that this is just the tip of the This is just the tip of the iceberg. It's just the tip of the knowledge out there. This is our 33rd week. We're building up on the knowledge. But like I said, I need you. I need you to help spread this knowledge. I need you to find more knowledge. That's why you have to buy my books. You have to buy the PDFs, because the PDFs are going to give you insight. They're going to give you information that can help you to see through the mist.
And Mr. Wilford just said, I like what you just said. He says, in my opinion, the people in the UFOs are black people and not the characters Caucasoids display. Yeah, absolutely right. We are Iron Man. Our goddesses are Wonder Woman and Wonder Women. That's all of those superheroes and all that. That's us. That's us.
And if you go back and you read the real literature in the 50s, they tell you that the people that they found on the spaceships were not gray. They were brown. They were black. And now, you know, but again, like I said, I don't go into that stuff because I leave them alone, because they're hooked up with the Dracos, so I leave them alone. I don't want no trouble with the Dracos. Leave them alone, baby. I don't mess with that. I stay in my lane.
Stay in your lane.
Yes.
All right, my beloved. So people are gonna go and download and get that PDF. And we'll keep building. I don't know if you want to spill a little bit of tea on what you're going to be bringing next week. Ah, see, you thought I was going to ask you about the affirmation. See how you do? See, I got you this time.
I don't know. I haven't decided on what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back on schedule because I didn't. I really didn't plan the last two lectures. I didn't plan the last lectures. They weren't on my calendars. I'll go back to the ones that we were going to do. The last two lectures, those were very interesting, you know. And but again, like I said, is that I'm not going back I'm going to try to get back on schedule. But I just wanted people to know. I want you guys out there to know that anything that you, you know, anything that you want to make, anything come to your mind, mm-hmm. you can do it because we already done it.
Mm-hmm.
We already mm-hmm. done it. I'm talking about
absolutely.
We've done technological stuff. I mean, they're already you know, brothers already made cars that could move, that could go off water.
They made
all type of ways to produce natural energy, natural consumption. See, the European, all he does is he depletes minerals. You know, he punches holes out of space. He punches holes around the planet. They're letting in all this stuff. But you can change it. But you have to stop. You have to stop. You have to stop believing that you have no volition. Yeah, they've done something to us, but you can remedy that.
Absolutely.
They thought that.
Absolutely.
I'm quite sure that when they let me into the University of Illinois in 1969, they said, we got another nigga that we're gonna train in the right way. And he's going to be one of our third, fourth frequency.
Mm-hmm.
But just like I was in the system, and I came out.
Mm-hmm.
I came out loving my people. I came out wanting to share.
And you came out loving yourself.
Yeah. I love myself. But I found love I was loving a black woman. I don't have nothing against no other woman on the planet. I have nothing against Asian women. I have nothing against white women, but it's nothing like a black woman.
That's right. That's right.
The mother goddess will take you on a trip. You see, I called my baby doll wonderful. Wonderful. Because of her power, her intuition, her sensitivity. See, because you sisters out there, stop letting people make a fool out of you. Show your genius. See, you don't have to go to no university. The university, I'm sad to say, the university is a place where second frequency can make up bullshit. The university is a place where second frequency can pretend that they're the smartest people on the planet by keeping out first frequency. If you've learned one thing from these past 33 weeks, is that you are a mighty, mighty, mighty people.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
You are intellectual people. You are people with a literacy, with writing. You wrote books. We even left our damn writing on the moon.
Wherever we were.
wherever
we landed.
But see,
that's right.
You'll be able to see your history. If you buy these PDFs, if you buy my books, you're going to know so much that when you see this and you see that, now I understand now, that.
Let me make a point of that, Dr. Winters, because I think we're in the middle of our 15-week research class with you, which is really an advanced PhD class of how to do research. Now, for some of you out there, fam, you've been with us for these 33 weeks that Dr. Winters has been on with us. You've seen the crescendo of all of this great, amazing scholarship. And one of the things that I did, reason why Dr. Winters jokes with me all the time about it being my fault, is because I asked him, I said, my beloved, we love the level of research that you do, and we know that you taught Dr. David Imhotep how to do primary research. Could you possibly teach us, the lay people, how to do primary research? Because one of the problems that I know I had is deciphering who's right, who's wrong. And you know we love to debate, and I don't like to debate. I just like to be correct. So I wanted to know, how do I structure and format my brain to know how to find first sight consciousness information and research. So Dr. Winters was gracious enough that he had taught this class many times in university, but this was the first time, perhaps the last time, that he is teaching his advanced research course online. So I'm happy to say that we're halfway through, and it has been. If everything stops right now, we will be badass as a result of what we just experienced. And so now we've got about another five or six weeks to go. And so I'm just really excited, Dr. Winters, about this research class. But I would really like for people who are serious about this and you really want to be a teacher, and particularly if you've got a platform and you like to debate and you like to talk about first frequency or whatever, get the class so you can learn how to do that level of research wherever you are in the world. And then at that point, nobody can fool you. You can just be able to go look at a paper, look at a website, look at a video, and you will know unequivocally where that information comes from, to look it up, to falsify, to challenge it, and what have you. Talk to us a little bit about what you're doing with us, Dr. Winters, now that we're so many weeks in with you.
Well, one of the things that I told the class earlier is that this class is aimed at providing people with the ability to understand any type of literature out there: anthropological, historical, linguistic, genetics, educational, social science, any type of knowledge. I've tried to inculcate in you guys so you would know how to understand it. Right now, you guys are doing the final, and then the final is when we give you when I've given you some data, and you have to analyze the data and move forward. I am kind of sad because Shanice, she brought the fact that it's a lot of people in Britain that wish they could have taken the class, but the class,
they can. You can still come in, and you're going to go through the replays. So I'm going to put that in there.
They won't get it through the
replays. But they're not going to have the live. They're not going to have the live interaction. That's true.
That, but they can come in. No, you don't come in now because you're not going to get the full experience. But I hate the fact that if we do this again, we'll probably have two classes. We'll have one class that'll start early so that we can get in those people overseas, and we'll have another class for maybe people in the United States if I do this again. And it'll be Reverend Matthew's fault too. But again, just looking at the taste would be good. But the point is this, is that, the class is a lot of money and you want to get the full experience. And since the class is a lot of money, I may do it again, but if I do it again, it'll be two classes. It'll be one for people overseas, one for here, but the only way I might would do that is if it's enough people in a sense who contact Reverend Matthews and say that they're interested, then I may do this again.
Yeah, that'll be fine. So Sister Shanice, you're out there. So hit me up. And if you can start to get a group of people together, let me know how many people are interested. I'll bring that back to Dr. Winters, and then we'll start setting up how we can make that a manifestation, because this is it's a lifetime opportunity. It's a once in a lifetime opportunity and like I said, I've gone through this course with him. I'm learning how to do primary research. My only regret is that I wish I had have had this prior to going through my master's and my doctorate. Because if I had have had this, what I know now, I should go. I literally want to go back and rewrite my dissertation and pump it up even more. But because it's just the level of being able to have power to find hardcore information and knowledge and do that primary research that nobody can come in and refute. You just shut the room down when you when you walk in the room with this level of knowledge. So yes, if y'all want to do this again, if y'all have missed it, you want to do it, send me an email, hit me up so I can start putting you on the list. Go ahead, Doc.
Yeah, no, the beauty of it is that a dissertation, you don't want to publish a dissertation. You had to change it around to make it plain for people. So it can still be published, but it would have to
I know about that. I'm just talking about all of the, you know, MLA versus APA and all of that good stuff that's just phenomenal in terms of that. But it's a pretty powerful piece.
And I think it's about four or five people who were in doctoral programs, but they weren't able to write their dissertations. And now I think they've said that they're going to be able now to go back and start taking their coursework and finish up. Because see, if you don't complete your dissertation, they say ABD. It's a whole lot of Black people that are ABD. ABD means all but the dissertation. And it's because of the fact that they don't know how to do the research to bring those ideas all together and compact
them
and write up the dissertation. Like I tell my students all the time, a lot of the people who are teaching around the country in many Black studies programs have their PhDs from our Temple. And they got a PhD, but they don't know how to do the research. So they concentrate just on teaching. We need people who can take what they've learned and turn that into real knowledge so that you guys out there and others can have the information to help grow the knowledge. See, it's all about knowledge building. It's all about, in a sense, being able to produce more and more knowledge. And the more people have that ability, hopefully, I'll admit, a lot of guys in the class right now think that this is some sort of mystery system. But by the time they're done, they're going to see that this is not a mystery system. It's very simple. But the point is that you're able to get together. The guys have started their own study group, you see? Mm-hmm. And they have a study group that comes together on Mondays, and now they're going to go into the weekend, and they're going to be, in a sense, sharing information to build themselves up. Because see, these are going to be the giants in our field.
Yep.
You're going to hear about the 30.
Yep. You're going to hear. Yep. It's 30 of us. Yeah. The dirty 30. You Clyde Winter's dirty 30. That's how we would call ourselves. That's them dirty 30s.
They're gonna set the world on fire, and it's so much knowledge out there, and it's waiting. One of our students is Magenta, and Magenta, she's over there in London, and I feel so sorry for Magenta, because she'd be trying to stay woke, and she'd probably be drinking.
Yeah, it's 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning there, right?
Yeah, the class right now. Yeah, is at 2:30.
But there's some dedication.
That's right, and the work that she's going to do.
She's
going to make the Black, the foundational Black Britain, she's going to make them proud, you see? She's doing some research that's not only going to be important research just in terms of the social science, but it's medical research.
Well, you know what you're doing? You're creating modern-day Drusilla Dungies, modern day Dubois, modern day Van Sertima. You're putting us, modern day Shake Out the Jopes. You're giving us the ability to do that level of historical research and bring that research up to date to now and start publishing papers and works and moving the community forward. Because one of the things we learned from working with you, Dr. Winters, is everybody pulls from research and then regurgitates the research based on their level of interpretation. So there are many of our scholars are the great, what I call the great regurgitators and the master regurgitators, because they can take all of the research and regurgitate it into a sequence and a process to be able to move the community forward. My issue was I want to be the one creating the research. I want to be able to one finding and discovering new information that has never been seen before, that nobody maybe have corroborated or looked at this hypothesis in this particular way before. That's what I and the group and the Dirty, the Clyde Winter's Dirty 30 can do.
The Dirty 30. the unique thing about my class is that it's not just about writing history. It's not just about writing anthropology. It's not just about writing psychology. It's all of the social sciences. Ever, because see, I recognize early that whatever it is, whatever form of research you guys want to do out there, I want to make it possible. And see, that's what this is all about. This is making the impossible possible. This is making the impossible possible. Because see, the so-called Dirty 30, you know, maybe one day there'll be the Dirty 60, the Dirty 100. Who knows? But again, I had to give you this week's lecture because this week's talk was telling you what you're capable of doing. As I told you, I love ancient history because ancient history tells you what you can do today. You're out there. You're a mighty nation. Be one. Be one.
Absolutely. Absolutely, beloved.
But you can't access, you know, the records that are out there. Nothing is lost. Mm-hmm. The knowledge is out there. And you can draw on that knowledge. The knowledge will come to you. How many people have seen the helicopter glyphs? How many people saw the bird model? But somehow God, Emma, gave me ability to put it all together for you. And that's what you can do too. But you got to be one. You got to be one. You got to be black first. Then you can put everything else into perspective.
Facts. All day, every day. All right, my beloved family. Okay, Clyde, it's time for you to do the affirmation of power. We go through this every week, y'all. I swear to God. I don't know what it is with this man. Now he's disappearing on me and stuff. Every single week, I gotta deal with this guy. All right, I guess he's not there. So I guess I have to do it. All right, family, here we go. Let's take a deep breath in and exhale. Let's give thanks and honks to this beloved elder, this beloved master teacher, this amazing researcher that is giving us our history back, placing us in our rightful place in history as the first history, the only history. And so for that, we simply say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
All right, my good family, this has been another one for the books. I say this every single week, don't I? Oh, what, you just outdid yourself. Well, he's always going to outdo himself because it's Dr. Clyde Winters. That's what he does. And he's B1 and he's African. So, of course, he's going to be the best of the best. That's what we're bringing to you. Uncle Job Sineb family.